And then yeah. I hit record on the video, and then it's like, remember the time we intro'd the show and didn't hit record on the video?
I remember that. Yeah. That was a long time ago.
Yeah, it was good. It was well. Brandon, welcome back. I'm so happy you're here in your travels. You sound better. You sound better than you did in a hotel. So thank goodness for
that's true.
For those that you're freeloading off of to reach their internets.
Yeah. Absolutely. When we did the thing in the hotel, it was Well, I just did the music for you, right?
Yeah, you didn't actually join live. Like
that's right. That's right.
You're just pre-recorded reverb.
And those were from the last time I used this setup, which was the 2i2 and this Rodecast mic. I was still in my house before I'd moved, and it was very echoey because all the other furniture had been moved out, and so now I'm pulling it out again. And there's like a bed in here. There's furniture all over the place and
padded walls. All of the things.
And the fan behind me is circulating the reverberations to make them just dulled and muted. It sounds great. But when I did the sound the music for Intermezzo RSS for Semi Perts and the main thing, I did that just with Apple AirPods in my Honda. And it just, God, those do not, if you're a podcast editor or a sound editor, do yourself a favor and do not try editing anything with audio on Apple AirPods because they are not fantastic.
the regular AirPods, the original, yeah. The OGs.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you don't get a lot of the EQ that you put in for editing. It just everything sounds like it's a tin can when you're listening to it over a dog.
Yeah,
so.
I got the AirPod Pros or whatever, and they have the like in ear where it like you gotta shove it in your ear canal, and they have like spatial audio on them and stuff. Those things rock my socks, and the noise canceling, I can completely block my family out entirely. And so yeah, I think there it's worth the upgrade, especially if your original AirPods stop charging, which is what mine did. So anyway,
go figure. Yes. But anyway, so I am now in Los Angeles, Travis. It's
one coast to the other.
It's such a weird dynamic shift, because we've gone from. We started podcasting in Hawaii, where we're same time zone, same crappy garage.
Yes, absolutely.
And then you moved to Omaha before I left Hawaii, and so then we're like 6 hours behind each other or something like that.
Can you believe we did that effectively? Like,
I don't remember, for
over a year. I think it was over a year that we
podcast
with like a 6 hour time difference.
Yeah. Well, I lived like 5 minutes from my house or from work. And so sometimes I would just be like, okay, I'm going on lunch. But then I go to Tampa. Then I'm 2 hours ahead of you.
It's just 1 hour.
Now, 1 hour ahead of you. And that worked. That was what we've done for the last 3 years and change.
It's too easy. Too easy. Perfect center.
And now I'm 2 hours behind you. And, rounding the bases with Robbie Askew and Matt Sizemore, they were like, we want to record today. And I was like, oh, I can be there for that. They want to do it mid morning. I was like, well, I can be there in the afternoon. They said, okay, we'll wait for you. They started recording at like 5:00. Right. And you and I talked about this a little bit last night, but it didn't occur to me that like 6:00 was coming up. And that was the time that we would normally record this podcast.
All of the shows.
So time differences are a heck of a thing.
And that's why it's really this episode is really about the complete abolishment of time zones. Standard time. Really, time is a construct that, I mean, do we really even need it?
One time to rule them all. It's what Lord of the Rings is all about.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to talk about Lord of the Rings through the context of time zones.
Frodo threw time into Mount Doom.
You just got to look at the layers, man. Okay. Like the entire, like the ring race are really, they're more like the perception of time coming after you. Like it's
right. Right. I feel you. And that answers the question. Why didn't the Eagles just take him to Mount Doom in the first place? Cause it didn't matter, bro. Time
really,
doesn't matter.
Really like Gandalf is like a calendar and he's like, he like understands not just like short term time, but like all
right.
time. Right.
Right. He's like a Julian calendar, right? Like there's no months. There's just numbers.
If he disappears in the mines of Moria, May, right? And you don't see him in June or July, that doesn't mean he's really gone. You just got to wait till like October, November, okay?
That's right. Gandalf the Grey, Gregorian calendar, okay? Gandalf the White.
It's all connected. Anyway, yeah, so this is a conversation that definitely wouldn't have happened if I was podcasting by myself.
No.
So thankful that you're back. How was the trip? How was you I believe you were backpacking across the United States, right?
That,
so
yeah.
So it was all just by foot. How did that go?
Well, the family and I, we got attacked by werewolves on the way backpacking over here. And it's a plot for my screenwriting gig, An American Werewolf in the Midwest.
Yeah, that's why you moved to LA. You were going to finally start shopping that screenplay around. And
you just
had to go out and live the adventure so that you could really bring that experience to the rewrite of the screenplay.
Yeah, I handed it to somebody at Del Taco yesterday, and they seemed really interested in it. They said they could introduce me to a producer.
They also asked if they could get more Del Scorcho sauce, which was kind of weird. But
Del Scorcho is delicious.
I will say that where I moved in Oklahoma, in the same time zone, because I care about this podcast, I live much closer to a Del Taco. There were no Del Tacos in Nebraska, and brings back some memories of delicious chicken soft tacos and other things.
I didn't know they had Del Tacos in Oklahoma City. That must be fairly new. Is that new?
I don't know. They're here now. Yeah. It looks relatively new. But
the first time I lived in Oklahoma City, they had a Wiener Schnitzel that had just gone out of business when I moved there.
No.
And guess what? I'm back. I'm back
in the land of Wiener Schnitzel. I ate so much Wiener Schnitzel when I was in California. I mean, I didn't eat that much, but I went like a couple times. And the second time
I went once.
I saw that they sell the cans of their chili, which I assumed was just like, you know, crushed up hamburgers from the day before or whatever. But they sell it by the can, and I was like, yeah, give me a can of that chili. Apparently the cans of chili are like $5.
Oh, my gosh.
But the lady gave it to me for like $2 or something. I was like, all right, that's fine. I still have that can of chili in my pantry, and I'm just waiting for the right night to recreate Wiener Schnitzel chili cheese dogs at the house. But
it's going to be glorious when that happens.
Sporting the In-N-Out shirt.
Nice.
For California, representing your move.
I still haven't eaten. I'm waiting for a special moment to break into my first In-N-Out being back here in LA.
Wow. You have a stronger will than I. I'm like, we're in California. I'm in like Arizona. I'm like, oh well, they have them here. Let's get a double double.
It's not a matter of stronger will. I'll talk more about travel here in a second. But when you have gone on a road trip from Tampa to California, it took us 5 days. And we were going to stop in Phoenix from El Paso, but instead we muscled through and said, no, let's just do the 12-hour drive rather than split it up into 2 6-hour drives. And in the middle of Texas, I found a Buc-ee's. There's a place called Buc-ee's. I don't know if you've ever heard of Buc-ee's.
I've heard of Buc-ee's. I've never been.
our Texas friends will recognize Bucky's as this massive kind of gas station in the middle of Texas, but they serve barbecue, and they also it's like a massive thing, and the mascot is this big ass dumbass looking beaver named Bucky. He looks so stupid. I'll send you a picture of the gremlin next to the Bucky's bag. But they have lots of beef jerky there, so I got beef jerky and then sunflower seeds, and that was the first time I started like really loading up on junk food for the trip, and this is halfway through. And then the next day we stopped near Phoenix, but there was a buy one get one free beef jerky bag of spicy beef jerky and more sunflower seeds. Well, we got to California, and that Mother's Day, we got here the night before Mother's Day. Mother's Day, I felt like kind of garbage. I ended up seeing my parents, and then just I felt like crap. And I didn't want to eat In-N-Out when I was feeling crappy.
Yeah, you want to enjoy it.
Exactly.
You don't want to.
That's the thing.
I have a Bucky's logo up on the video, dude. Also. So
look how stupid that thing looks.
Yeah.
I'm Bucky.
That really shows how awful my teeth are. Invisalign, sponsor us.
Oh my god. I'm gonna Photoshop you onto a Bucky's logo. Okay. So I'm saving In-N-Out because my stomach is almost good now.
That's good. But the
trip was good. We stopped in Sandestin, which is in Florida. It's near kind of Panama Beach ish. And then we stopped at New Orleans the next day.
NOLA.
And NOLA. Nolans.
Who dat?
Who dat? Who dat? And we got there. It was one of my good friends, longtime friends. He works for hotel chains, and he hooked us up with a hotel right there on Bourbon Street at the Royal Sonesta. And getting to the Royal Sonesta, we got into New Orleans right around like 5 p.m. in the afternoon, which is right about the time they're about to close down Bourbon Street to any through traffic because people are already getting drunk then.
Sure.
There are two
for 5 hours at that point.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. There are two entrances to this hotel, and they're underground garages. And if you put in directions for the wrong one, it's going to take you to Bourbon Street, and if Bourbon Street's closed, then you can't get to it. So then you got to put in the other one. So Chelsea and I were navigating through these small streets, and these small streets, there's lots of one ways, there's lots of stop signs, but there's not always a stop sign at every corner. And you never know which one's one way. So you end up stopping at every street anyway, just to make sure you don't hit anybody or hit any cars. Chelsea.
And you guys are driving separately. Two cars, right?
Two cars. Two cars. Two cars. Two drivers. I have a 9-year-old. She has a 3-year-old dog. At some point in time, she's following.
I want to pick at like how those lots were cast, but we'll get to that another time.
She was happy to take the dog. so we're driving through these small streets, and all of a sudden we're following the GPS, and she has the GPS for the other entrance to this garage, and hers I have one for the other one, and so she makes a right. She doesn't follow me. She makes a right on a random street, and where I'm talking to her on the phone, I'm like, why'd you turn right? She's like, it's GPS told me to. Okay. So I'm like, okay, stay there. I'll meet back up with you. I get to it's Rampart Drive, Rampart Street. It's a main street there in New Orleans, so there's a light and everything. It's not one of those one way weird ass roads. And I'm at the light, behind maybe one or two cars. Behind me, there's a 5 or 6. All of a sudden, I hear just sirens all over the place. I see like cops like pass on the cross street. Whoa. I'm like, oh god, and behind me I see the lights start flashing, and they're trying to get past all these cars, and they're narrow streets, so like there's like honking and horn, like get the f out of the way. Okay, this cop car passes me, makes a right, and then immediately stops, because as soon as you make that right, there was like police line do not cross, the police tape, a bunch of cop cars. And I told Chelsea on the phone, I'm like, I think somebody just got murdered. And just joking, right? Like, yeah. I think somebody just got murdered. And she's like, oh, great, cool. Well, Matt Sizemore, who's a newscaster over in KIVI, Idaho, he was talking to me the next day, and I joked with you about getting being near murder. I joked with him the next morning about being near a murder. And he's like, I have a buddy who's a newscaster in New Orleans, and he just reported about a murder that happened yesterday. And he sent me the picture. Sure enough, I was there when it happened. Can't convict me. It wasn't me.
He got out of that town and set off across the country. You'll never lickety catch splits.
We'd like Thelma and Louise, me and the 9-year-old. But
all right. Well, did you have a particularly like favorite stop along the trip, or did it feel like a trip you could enjoy, or did it feel just like get to the destination? Like, I don't know. Was it?
Ooh, yeah. Matt kept asking me every time we stopped, like, are you seeing anything fun in San Antonio? Like, no, we're moving.
The largest ball of twine.
The largest boot. No, it was weird because we were just trying to get to the hotels that we had set up. And then once we got to the hotels and we're just like, we're beaten. We just kind of hung out. We didn't do anything else.
Yeah.
And the next day we started up again, but we didn't feel rushed. We didn't feel like we were like driven to a goal necessarily, but at the same time, you know, you and I, we have friends that we know in basically all these cities that we go to. Sure. I have a grandfather in Shreveport, which is
all
north
you
of...
loyal listeners of Apathetic Enthusiasm and Interdimensional RSS.
That's right.
Our
that's
friends
right.
Across the nation.
And I feel bad because, like, friends in San Antonio and they're like, oh, you stopping by, when you coming through? And you know this when you go visit.
I was like, you're gonna be 8 hours south of me. Why aren't we hanging out?
Yeah, yeah, you know it. But you know, it's because we saw you on the way to Tampa. We're not gonna see you again.
Yeah,
exactly. If we can help it. But you know, like visiting people. You can say, yeah, we're just going to stop by, visit people for like 30 minutes. But even if you say like hard 30 minutes, you're going to, the first 30 minutes is going to be like, hey, how's everything? Oh, come on in, have a drink, blah, 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 have some water. You know, you want some water? Then 30 minutes after that, then you're like, okay, we're going to go. Then it's 30 minutes saying goodbye to people. And so if you get there at 5 p.m. after a long day of driving, that turns into an hour and a half to 2 hours. And then, you know, it's not that we don't want to see people. It's that it's time. We're like, we don't want to be bad guests either. You know, we don't want to be like I didn't want to. Original plan was to come into California on Sunday, Mother's Day, and then surprise my mom in like the afternoon, surprise Chelsea's mom, surprise my mom in the afternoon. We're so happy that we just drove straight through on that Saturday because it would, you know, when you've been driving, you can't have a conversation with people because you're like,
my body still feels like it's moving across the country.
Do you want anything to drink? I don't know. Yeah.
No. Is it on this exit or the next one? When? Where do I?
I gotta pee. I gotta pee again. Can we pull over in 5 minutes to pee again?
Speaking of road trip beverages, if I'm not mistaken, I believe one of your stops you picked up a Topo Chico.
I did. Chelsea,
the fine bottled beverage, the spicy rock water my family loves so much. what were your thoughts?
Oh my gosh! First of all, I don't think I would have picked up a Topo Chico on my own. Even if I had seen one, I would have been like, "Oh, hey Travis," and I would have taken a picture of it for you, and been like, "Look, I saw a Topo Chico. Funny.
Hey, look, there's one." Yep.
But one of the stops, I didn't get out of the car, and Chelsea got out of the car, went inside, and she came back with a bunch of drinks. She's like, "Hey, I got some Topo Chicos," and she's like, "You want one?"
I heard about them on this podcast.
Yeah, she's a frequent listener. Hi, Chelsea. I love you so much. I'll give you $1,100. Hold me to it. So she's like, "I have a grapefruit. I have a lemon lime." I'll try the lemon lime. And, you know, they're pretty good. Topo Chico. pretty good.
Don't knock them. Topo Chico. That's their slogan. Nope. Don't knock them.
They owe us so much money for that slogan.
Come
if
on,
they ever use.
Just I will put Apathetic Enthusiasm brought to you by Topo Chico on our banners, everything. Just
hey,
sponsor this podcast.
Speaking of sponsor the podcast, I don't know how often or how closely pay attention to our Instagram. And maybe we shouldn't talk about that live on the air. I don't pay attention to it at all. But there was a general message that we got from somebody on our Instagram, and they were like, we looked at your account. First of all, like, we don't have that many followers on Instagram, so that makes me hesitant and suspicious instantly. But they're like, we think you'd be a good fit as ambassadors to our team. And it's an advertisement for I should just pull up the Instagram. It's like Clean Balls or something like that.
They just saw a picture of me, didn't they?
They may have Clean Balls.
Yeah, now I have to look at this too. I completely ignored it.
Oh man. Yeah, Clean Ball. One request. Oh, Greg Wright. It says looked over your profile. Seems like you're a great match at Smooth My Balls. Is interested in working with you. Can you drop them a message here at Smooth My Balls? Thanks a lot. Give them a message and they'll get back to you ASAP. Do I want to accept message requests from Greg? I don't think so. But Smooth My Balls is like
Smooth My Balls.
It is an actual account. It is an actual company that they give like
I thought like Manscaped like was a bold branding choice.
Smooth My Balls. But they give some clippers. They have 471,000 followers. DM to be an ambassador, free worldwide shipping. They have a something. I don't know how good you can see this. It's the pube muncher. It's something called the pube muncher, which I guess is like kind of like when you go to like Chuck E. Cheese and it's a ticket muncher. You get like a really long pube and it goes down, 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 down.
Wait, counts how long it is?
Yeah. Yeah. Yo, 500 pubes. And like the more pubes you put in, like the bigger prize you get. That's great.
We should be
Smooth
brand ambassadors. Hey, listen, use the promo code AEPOD. For 0% off your next order.
Oh my god! Anyways,
maybe we should reach out to him.
I think so. I'm convinced that Smooth My Balls is even for an international RSS. You know, like
hey,
those are the kinds.
If they offer skincare solutions, I like to make sure this stays, you know, nice and supple. So, and for the audio listeners, I'm pointing to my bald head, and not my balls.
Not your balls. Yeah. Travis doesn't show his balls on live stream. No, that's
not anymore.
No, that is a Clubhouse exclusive.
Oh yeah, we should finally break into Clubhouse. That's where we're really gonna take this podcast to the next level. All right. Well, all right. So all right. You've toured across the country. You, family dynamics. You guys make it safely. There are no robot apocalypses that happen while you're on your road trip. Much unlike the movie that is taking the internet by storm, the Netflix release, The Mitchells versus the Machines. This is a movie that has sort of been expected for a while. My son has been hyped for this movie for what feels like a year.
Really?
And it's out now. It's available on Netflix for those of you with a Netflix subscription. Yeah, I believe this movie was rebranded with a different title. I'm trying to see if I can figure out what that was. But it was a movie that my son was really excited about. I was like, yeah, okay, it looks like some decent animation, I guess, but I don't know. I don't know if I'll watch it. And then he's like, oh, it's super good. And then you watched it, and you were like, man,
yeah.
Have you heard about this movie? You got to check it out. So I was like, all right, I guess I'll watch it. So How did you end up watching this movie?
Well, we had just moved out of our house, and we were in the first hotel that we're staying in, and I think Chelsea had mentioned it to our son, and you know, when we have nothing, we have an iPad and we got a laptop and we got the hotel TV, right? There's not a lot of stuff to watch or to do, and we're just in such a limbo that I was like, well, okay, I heard them talking about this movie that they were looking forward to seeing, or that my kid was looking forward to seeing. Yeah, let's do that. Let's spend some family time together before we all get angry at each other and on the road, right? So like, yeah, it's a good idea. Let's do it. So I hooked my laptop up to the TV, and we put it on. I had never heard of the movie. I'll say this. I had heard of the movie that day because folks on Twitter were just all a flutter about the Mitchells versus the Machines.
That's how people on Twitter react to things. They flutter.
And a lot of people were saying really good things about it and hyping it up. And they're saying, you know, Lord Miller, their production with Sony, they did again. The animation was just fantastic. And so I'd heard them, Chelsea, mention it before, and I'm like, okay. And then I saw on Twitter that people were talking about it, and so that just kind of congealed to, yeah, let's do this for family time. So put it on, and like within like 10 minutes of the movie start, maybe not even 10 minutes, I was just like, this is so good. It's so funny, like legitimately funny, yeah, for adults and kids that were like, we're both cracking up. That before I even got like deep into the movie, I had sent you a message and I said, have you seen this? Did you know about this? Because I had no idea.
Yeah. So when my son had originally started kind of tracking this movie, it was intended for a theatrical release under the title Connected, is what it was originally called. It was supposed to be back in 2020, but due to COVID-19 and everything, it never made it to theaters. So Sony sold the rights, the distribution rights to Netflix, which is why it ended up direct to your screens. And then they retitled it The Mitchells versus the Machines. So yeah, I remember seeing an early trailer. I thought the concept looked okay, because I was like, all right, like robot apocalypse, whatever. Like it didn't at first seem like a very original idea, but where this movie really kind of steps out and sets itself apart early on is that blending of visual styles, where the main character in the movie, I'm trying to think of her name.
Katie.
she is a young filmmaker. She expresses herself through making movies, and a lot of the effects and style that she has becomes part of this movie itself, and she uses a lot of like GIF type overlays and fun like little animations and things like that, and it sort of kind of has that same craziness that you get in Lego Movie, where just weird vignettes where all of a sudden we're like, we're gonna do something a little off the wall, but it's a fun kind of tone to the movie. And so the movie, if you haven't seen it, basically follows a family who is getting ready to send their oldest daughter off to college across the country. She's going to LA for film school, but the dad is like more of like a work with your hands traditional type dude, and he doesn't fully get it.
Which is much like me.
My voice has completely left me at this point. And so he decides, we're going to take a road trip. We're going to spend this last bit of family time together. And in the midst of their road trip, Alexa becomes sentient and ends up sending a robot horde to capture all humans on Earth.
Yes, yeah. Now I'm watching this film at the start of a road trip to Los Angeles. And I don't know if you know this about me, fair listener, but I like movies a lot. And my son, 9 years old, he's now attaining sentience a little bit, where he realizes that I'm messing with him a lot of times. He tries to mess back with me, like joking wise, and he gets annoyed at me. Like he's you tell your kids, you're gonna get annoyed at me eventually, and like, no, Dad, I'll always love you. And like, yeah, you say that now, but it's you just wait.
Give it 2 to 3 years.
Yeah. And he's getting to that point now. And so watching the father, played by Danny McBride, try to still relate with his daughter, who, they have a strained relationship, because they don't seem to click so much, and they're going on a road trip, and he's trying to let her go and let her grow older and let her, spread her wings. It's just like, this, it's still a little bit further out, but it's still close to home in a certain way, of just, and especially when you watch your kid grow up and watch them figure out that they start to realize they're an actual person and have their own music preferences and their own movie preferences, and everything you try to instill in them, force on them, like this movie, like these songs, like this food. They're like, that's not us anymore. Like, I'm gonna find my own.
I have developed my own style and my own preferences.
Yeah.
Like, but those aren't my preferences. Those aren't the things I like.
This isn't the music I made you listen to over and over again. What is this?
Yeah.
He listens to Five Nights at Freddy's remixes a lot, just all the time. And
so nice to meet you, or whatever that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm dealing with that similar situation with my eldest child. She is getting into like some anime content, which I've dabbled, but never really committed. There's a show that I was possibly going to talk about tonight, but now I'm going to make you watch a few episodes so that we can talk about it in earnest on an upcoming episode. But My Hero Academia, she had some friends that were like, yeah, let's watch this show. She checks it out. She's like, it's so good, Dad. It's so good. You have to watch it. And so I'm like, oh, okay, I'll check out a few episodes. She's like, no, the first season isn't great. You gotta push through. I'm like,
typical,
okay.
typical line for any new show.
Sure. And the concept, I was like, all right, I can understand the appeal here. But then I'm like halfway through the second season, and I'm like, this is actually pretty good. There's some cool storylines here. There's some cool stuff happening. And now I'm like, oh, we should watch more My Hero Academia. It's like it's like me turning it on instead of her being like, Dad, let's watch more.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm interested now, but it's definitely one of those things, like you said, where it wasn't my taste, it wasn't my thing, and it's 100% like seeing my kid develop her own style and her own stuff that she likes, so.
Yeah, I remember so on the road trip, listening to my son's playlist of like cartoon cat stuff and Bendy and
Jellicle's
the Ink.
King, 'cause Jellicle's
No, Cartoon Cat is like some weird like meme where it's like it'll kill you, kind of like Slender Man. Bendy and the Ink Machine, which is another like kind of horror game. He
Yep.
really likes horror games, right?
That's so weird. I
horror.
wouldn't imagine
My
growing up in
son.
your home. That's no,
Yeah,
I don't think we ever
yeah.
could have put that together.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Whatever. But so I'm listening to, I to bond with him, to get him off of his iPad, watching an iPad on the road trip. I'm like, okay, let's put your playlist, turn the iPad off. We'll listen to your music. And So we listen to music a lot, and some good songs on there, right? I would never have sought them out. And it reminded me of when I was like, you know, probably 11, 12, 13, that young age, driving with my dad in his 1990 Ford Ranger. And I put on like Punk-O-Rama 2. And he was listening to all this Punk-O-Rama music with me. And there's like the Sons of Liberty song where it's talking about, the song is called Code Blue, and it's talking about going out to the mortuary and having sex with the dead. You know, and my dad listening to this stuff and letting me listen to this and let me sing to it, and I'm like, oh man, it's a circle of parenthood.
Yeah, it's really weird turning that corner a little bit now and being like, oh, like these humans that are gonna have their own, you know, style, opinions, tastes. And then they're going to, like, leave. They're going to leave me and Sheena alone. And we'll just spend all day just missing them and wishing they would make our house dirty again. Just and like that's Mitchell's what... in the machine.
Yes. We're not quite the father character, right? Yeah. But everybody is every parent is a little bit like that. And so that really sticks out in this film. It is a very good movie. It is very, very funny. If you have kids, you will, if you not shed a tear, you will think about shedding a tear, because it does have an emotional arc to it. I will say the animation is fantastic. The color design, and I don't know exactly what terminology you use for it. The way they colors as shadows on the animation of the main characters, the kind of the blend of that sci-fi with the robot apocalypse, the robots doing their like really badass stuff with the more I say Pixar-y, but more of the cartoonized family aspects of it, blended perfectly.
A cell shading aspect to this, like animation, where it is some of the same teams that worked on Into the Spider-Verse, and so there's I don't know, there's notes you can pick up on, I think, in the visual styles, but yeah, really, really great animation, and again with that blending of stuff that is supposed to be happening, and then there's like, I don't know, stuff that pops out or whatever, and so I don't know, it's just really fun. I highly recommend it. If you don't have
check
kids,
it out.
Check it out. If you do have kids, check it out.
It should win. As of right now, it should win best animated feature for next year's Oscars.
Yeah, until Luca comes out or whatever the next Pixar movie is. Which looks phenomenal. If you have not seen,
I haven't seen
the
it.
Trailer for that.
No,
I think it's called.
Oh, that's the one with the Cletus Cassidy, played by Woody Harrelson. And
are you talking about Venom?
Venom 2. Let There Be Carnage.
Let There Be Carnage. I watched that trailer today because it came out today. Did you watch that Venom movie?
I did.
Yeah.
Was Tom Hardy.
Good?
I enjoyed it.
I 100% missed it.
Oh.
So but that trailer today made me think, like, I should go back and watch this Tom Hardy version of Venom.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I saw on Twitter today, because somebody, they were commenting on the Venom 2 trailer, and they said that the first Venom was Tom Hardy realizing it's a comedy, and the rest of the production team trying to still make it like a mid 90s non Marvel film.
Right.
That doesn't make it sound very good, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it. Tom Hardy's good.
I feel like the trailer leans into the comedy a lot more.
Yeah. Yeah.
For this movie. And so I don't know. I'm interested in it.
Check it out.
I never read a lot of like Venom comics as a kid or anything. So I'm not all up to speed on, like, I get some of the symbiote stuff or whatever. And but I don't know.
We'll just know that venom is injected and poison is ingested. That's the main difference you need to understand about venom versus poison.
There you go. That's what you need to know, everybody.
That's all you need to know.
All right. Well, I don't know. Is there anything else? Anything else going on? Anything else you're hyped about? Anything else on your mind, Brandon? I don't.
Here's the very last thing about traveling. I'm here with my in-laws, and one of the things that we did, I talk about Joe Bob Briggs all the time, right?
Sure.
You asked me about Creepshow, you asked me about what's on Shudder, you asked me about Joe Bob Briggs, and during the travels, Joe Bob has been on still every Friday night. We watched it the first Friday night in our first hotel. On the East Coast, which starts at 9, right? We watched it in El Paso here this last Friday, which is 2 hours earlier.
Yep.
But I didn't realize that. I was like, oh my God, this is starting so early. Oh my God, the first movie's over and it's not even 10 o'clock yet. Oh my God. And now I'm in California where it's like, oh no, it starts at 6 in the evening. So I'm here watching it with my father-in-law. We started watching one of the Joe Bob reruns, and it's such a interesting thing to be. My father-in-law, I'll say, knows a lot about old school movies, old school horror films, and just sitting there next to him and like listening to Joe Bob talk about all this old type of stuff, and being like, You get it, man. And he's like, he doesn't say that to me, but I can feel it.
You can sense it.
And I don't have to say anything to him. And it's bonding. You know, it's father son-in-law bonding. And he's like, you know what? I'll forget that you stole her from the family and you gave her your name and took shower away. This is fine. This is an acceptable solution.
You watch a guy in a lawn chair talk about horror movies, so that makes up for it.
That makes up for it. Yeah, but do not have sex in our house. It's an unspoken thing, but it's
it's unspoken, but you can see it in his eyes.
Yeah. There's a twinkle. Yeah. A twinkle in his eyes.
Yeah.
Even when
I stayed there, I felt it. Like it was. Yeah. Just, yeah, it was.
He's like, Travis, do not have sex in this house.
It's like, I won't now. Jeez. All right. Well, I'm happy to hear that you've made it safely across the country. I don't know what I would have done, if you had died in a terrible fiery car crash, because, frankly, you're the one that uploads all of our episodes. So I just really don't know what I would have done. But yeah.
you would have been fine, Travis.
I could Google it. I'd figure it out.
I want to commend you for solo podcasting for one podcast.
It's one. I like how I left for like a month and you had to do like three or four of them, and then you are gone for one Monday. Yeah.
Well, you have more kids, and there's many more moving parts in your life to have to kind of juggle. I trained Chelsea long ago that like you do not fuck with my podcasting life.
There's like podcasting, my career, our son,
in and out. You. Okay.
Don't forget, yep. Chelsea, mention this podcast for you to get $1,100.
$1,100. I do want to shout out two folks in the Twitch chat. Ol have a good day face. Brobot VR was here for a little bit. Hey, you might still
bro,
be here.
Come back for the anime episode. Can't wait to talk about it.
Three folks, and then Robbie from Rounding the Bases. I want to Matt asked this question, but he didn't ask it. It wasn't a question, but he said, you guys should talk about Nolan's Batman and why he's forced to talk in Batman voice, even when it's just him and Alfred, but he's in the bat suit. Why does he do that? Why does he do that, Travis? That's questions from the Twitch chat.
So, I think maybe in Nolan's Bat-iverse, release the Nolan cut.
Bat-iverse? Why do you have the "ih" in the...
universe? Bat-iverse?
Okay. Oh, okay. All right.
Also,
sorry.
I just remembered there's a Carnage mug in our backsplash from a long, long Loot Crate ago.
That's right.
Totally planned for and
shout out.
Anyway. So he's a method actor, right? And when he puts on that bat suit, when he doffs the cowl,
doff?
Do you take it on, off, doff? What is doffing?
That's a good question, actually. I was like, that's stupid, Travis, you're being stupid. Oh wait, no, if he dons, then what if... Oh shoot! Yeah, you're right.
So,
oh my god,
when he's wearing the suit, he's Batman. He's got a feel that he's Batman through and through, and so that's why he does this stupid voice.
maybe by the time he's done speaking that way, then he's just like it's not that he doesn't that he wants to keep doing it. It's just like his throat is sore. He's already so sore.
He's like Travis on this episode. He just
oh God!
His voice right,
Alfred. Have a batch of lozenges for me.
Make sure that the utility belt has Ricolas in it.
Ricolas, very specific. It has to be Ricola. It has to be Ricola.
He's a man of refined taste. You don't grow up in the Wayne household. And then just pop up balls, menthol.
Alfred, why are you packing my belt with Halls? This the last time my parents died on Halls.
Yeah, they always show in the comic books as the pearls scattering all over the ground, but it was actually they ripped open a pack of Hall's cough drops, and those were skittering all over the alley.
No, it's like the Lucrets. Like they came in like little tin, like the cherry Lucrets.
Man, those things are like candy.
Do not give me Lucrets. Jeez.
I will eat
destroy
so many
them.
Cough drops.
Same thing with like orange Tic Tacs. Like, are these really breath mints at this point in time? No.
When I'm popping them, like I don't know, something you pop a lot of.
You smell like oranges.
Have you watched Tenet? Speaking of Nolan, have you watched Tenet yet?
I haven't. No, I know it's spelled the same way forward and backwards.
Mm. Oh, I wonder if that's intentional. It is available streaming now on HBO Max. So. It's something I plan to watch in the near future. Maybe between that and My Hero Academia, we can plan ahead for a future Apathetic Enthusiasm.
All right, that's good call. Good call. Speaking of planning ahead, you talked to Alex Fearer, Fred Stressing. If you are a fan of Rick and Morty, the comics they have their kind of like one shots out there. Rick's New Hat is coming out in the comic world, by Alex Fearer, drawn by Fred Stressing. We had them on. They drew and wrote the Bird Person Rick and Morty comic.
That's right.
Travis, you're going to do an interview with them. I might, if I'm available, then I will be there to help out with it.
If you can find a room to podcast in, we will make it happen. But
depends on the 405. That's really what it depends on.
I was thinking about it on my commute home today. Hoping to get a few more interviews lined up between now and June 20th, when we can expect brand new episodes of Rick and Morty to start airing. So if you come here for the Rick and Morty, but you stay for the Apathetic Enthusiasm, That's something that I'm looking ahead to and trying to figure out. So, and just in case Brandon decides to, you know, abandon me ever again.
It's not solo podcasting if it's an interview. Remember
that's right.
That.
That's right. That's right. All right, everybody. Well, that is our time. Thank you guys so much for listening. Thank you for watching. Brandon is gonna be found eventually. He did not tell his family that he was gonna be hiding in this room. I think there's an Amber Alert out for him right now in California.
Yeah, yeah. Well, not in California, in New Orleans.
Oh, it's still in New Orleans.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for listening. If you're new to this podcast and you enjoyed it, please subscribe, share it, review it wherever you consume this podcast. And yeah, we just appreciate you guys listening. Thank you guys so much for being here. Until next time, I'm Travis.
And I am Brandon, and thank you so much for listening.
Yeah, bye. This is the bonus for just a video people. For
half a second.
If you're watching on video on YouTube, thanks for being awesome. Sorry I started it late. Brandon's leaving. Bye.
Ow, my leg.